Exercise 1. In the previous video, we saw that special exercise, we solved it. So in this video, we are properly starting the exercises. So the first one asks us to show that Rx is a commutative ring with unit element when R is a commutative ring with unit element. Now, recall that when we introduced polynomials for the first time in ring theory, we did that with polynomials over a field, that is polynomials in X where the coefficients came from a field. There it was mentioned that this set Fx forms a ring under addition and multiplication of polynomials. And I asked you to verify this fact, verify all the axioms one by one and see that actually, yes, this is a ring. If you have done that, if you have gone through that verification, you must know that in that verification, in showing that Fx is a ring, we don't fully use the nature of F as a field, particularly the fact that non-zero elements in F have multiplicative inverses play no role in that verification. It plays no role in showing that Fx is a ring. That means in place of F you can write R, because here in showing that Fx is a ring we only used the fact that F is a ring with unit element that is commutative. We did not fully need the field nature of F. We need the field nature of F only in showing that Fx is a Euclidean ring, namely to show that you can divide a polynomial by a non-zero polynomial to get a quotient and a remainder, that thing. Okay, there you need that existence of multiplicative inverses for non-zero elements in F. So I don't know if you have actually done that verification or not. If you have done that, then from there itself it automatically follows that Rx is a ring. And not just that, since we showed that Fx, I mean in that verification, it comes out as a fact that Fx is not only a ring but a commutative ring with unit element. So the same is true for Rx also. So as solution, I will just simply write, do it yourself. You should do it at least once so that you know exactly why this is true. I mean, we keep on hearing, yes, Fx is a polynomial ring, but one should see all the things for once at least. We then move to the second one. Prove that this is equal to this, where the vector or n-tuple, whatever you may want to call it, it's the same thing, where this is a permutation of this. In other words, the indeterminates here have been rearranged, okay, according to some permutation. If we do that, basically nothing changes. The ring remains the same. But strictly speaking, things change. Because you see, suppose you have three indeterminates, then in R x1, x2, x3, a general element looks like this. A say I1, I2, I3. Or if you are getting confused with these I1s and these I1s, let me write J. Where these J1, J2, J3, these are non-negative integers, and this finite sum, you already know what these symbols are. Oh no, I cannot actually say that, no? I cannot actually say that because according to our definition, this will come later. No, I myself got confused. This is the ring of polynomials in X3, where the coefficients are coming from this ring. Whereas in its place, if you think of this one, say x1, x3, x2, then this is, in fact, this is equal to, by definition, this. Whereas by definition, this is equal to this. Here we have polynomials in X3 with coefficients coming from this. Here we have polynomials in X2 with coefficients coming from this. And strictly speaking, these are two different things. But still we have to show that these two are isomorphic. Okay. In this form, it's extremely difficult to see why there should be an isomorphism in the first place. But this is where the special exercise from the previous video will help us. Let us see. And from this example, we also see that these are not strictly going to be equal, but although the author has written equality here, but he really meant isomorphic. We have to show that this is isomorphic to this. So let's start the solution by mentioning that. Note that xn equal to really means this. By the special exercise above, we can say above because if you merge this video with the previous one, then this one, I mean the special exercise comes before these two. This is isomorphic to and these isomorphisms tell us that yes, now we can consider the elements in, say, let's go back to that example. Like this, we have a coefficient here, no need to write all those things, we just need to understand what is going on. So this is J1, J2, X3 to the power J3, and a typical element in the second ring will look like this, X1 to the power J1, X3 to the power J2, X2 to the power J3. You have to understand that this J1, J2, J3 are not fixed non-negative integers. They are variables which take on values that are non-negative integers. So they have been used as dummy variables. Okay. In place of J1, you can write something else also. You can in fact write A, B, C. Nothing will change. Now, technically speaking, this and this are actually two different things, strictly speaking, because the symbols look different. Here X3 comes in the middle, but note that according to this identification, I mean the way we obtain this isomorphism, we actually identified X1 with that element X1 star. If you go back to the special exercise, you will know what I mean. X2 with X2 star and X3 with X3 star. So we can write this sum like this. And this sum like this. And when we write, when we use these stars, instead of being an abstract symbol, a formal symbol, this actually becomes a sum in the given ring. Okay, given ring means this, where these are integral powers of the elements x1 star, x2 star, x3 star in this ring. And they have been multiplied. So unlike this formal symbol, here we have actual multiplication in the ring, because these are elements of the ring. In the formal symbol, individually x1, x2 and x3 held no meaning. Individually they were meaningless. They got some meaning only by being a part of this formal symbol. But now individually x1 star has a meaning. It has been defined in that solution in the previous video to the special exercise, and it is a particular element in this ring. So we have this thing, this linear combination of some elements in the ring. I mean, we have taken products of integral powers of these elements, multiplied them by scalars which are coming from the ring R, and we have added up those products, those terms. And since these rings are commutative, now we can say that yes, this thing is actually equal to this, because you can interchange the positions of x2 star and x3 star, provided the exponents are also same. So that means you can change the order of these indeterminates, albeit in these isomorphic rings, not directly here, but here. So we are now going to write these things. And we will write like this. Because of the identification, xi with xi star, where I of course varies from 1 through n, and because the rings, this one and this one, are commutative it follows that they are actually equal. Now we have written isomorphic, same thing, isomorphic ring, I mean equal rings are also isomorphic. This and this are isomorphic because here you can interchange the orders of the these indeterminates. So now this is isomorphic to this, this is isomorphic to this, and this is again isomorphic to this. Hence, that shows that order can be, you can interchange the indeterminates, I mean rearrange the indeterminates in any way you want. Then exercise 3, if R is an integral domain, prove that for non-zero, the hypothesis that the polynomials we are now going to consider should be non-zero is not there in the text. But for non-zero polynomials, we have not defined any notion of degree. So I am assuming this hypothesis extra. Non-zero fx and gx in Rx. That degree formula this will be equal to degree of fx plus degree of gx, not how non-zeroness of fx and gx now makes this thing meaningful. Since R is an integral domain, we already know that Rx is also an integral domain. We have a result that says this. And that's why, since fx and gx are non-zero, so their product will also be non-zero because they are elements in the integral domain. So degree of this polynomial makes sense. First of all, it is defined. Just like that, since fx and gx are non-zero, their degrees also exist. And we have this equation. We have already proved a similar thing where in place of R, we had a field. And in that proof, we only used the fact that the field is an integral domain. So we don't really have to do anything. We will, in place of a solution, we will write this. Most of what we did for a polynomial ring over a field carries over verbatim to this setting, this more general setting. The proof of lemma Lemma 391 only uses the fact that F is an integral domain. So lemma 391, if you recall, is just this result where in place of R you have a field. And in that proof we only used the fact that F is an integral domain. So that same proof works here also. Then 4. If R is an integral domain with unit element, prove that any unit in Rx must already be a unit in R. For this one also, we will refer to another special exercise that we saw in section 3.9. The solution to that exercise gives a direct answer to this. If you I think it was something like this. We considered the polynomial ring fx and we proved that the units in fx, that is the elements in fx that have multiplicative inverses in fx, are precisely the units in f, which are the all the non-zero elements in f. Using that same idea, one can attack this problem. see the solution. To the special exercise, in section 3.9 is the section named polynomial rings. Okay, now finally we come to an exercise where we have to write the solution. Let R be a commutative ring with no non-zero nilpotent element. That is, a to the power n equal to 0 implies a is equal to 0. Then, if fx is equal to a naught plus a1x etc. plus amx to the power m in Rx, is a zero divisor. Prove that there is an element B which is non-zero in R. Such that multiplying all the coefficients of F by B gives us 0. That is, B A naught, B A 1, etc. all of them B A M are equal to 0. Okay, now what is a nilpotent element? Say you have a ring in which you choose one element A. For that element A, if you can find some positive integer n such that this power becomes equal to 0, then A is called a nilpotent element, and the smallest positive n for which this happens is called the degree of nilpotency of A. Note that in any ring, 0 is trivially a nilpotent element with degree of nilpotency 1. But non-zero nilpotent elements also exist. For example, if you look at the ring Z4 of congruence classes modulo 4, under addition and multiplication mod 4, then this is an nilpotent element, it's the zero element, but you see this so 2 square is 0 and one can clearly see that the degree of so this is a nilpotent element, another one whose degree of nilpotency is 2. You can find other nilpotent elements in matrix rings or some other rings. Note that in the ring of integers the only nilpotent element is the zero element, the additive identity. No non-zero integer is a nilpotent element. Keep in mind that a to the power n in this context means actually product of a with itself n times. N copies of a have been taken and their product, not sum. Okay. So it is given that R is a commutative ring with no non-zero nilpotent element. Okay, there is no zero, of course, is nilpotent, but other than that, there is no nilpotent element, just like the ring of integers. Now, under this condition, if we consider a polynomial in Rx and in Rx as an element, this is a zero divisor, then there must be a non-zero element in R such that this happens, with which if you multiply all the coefficients you get 0. If we are now going to solve this, so it tells us something about the nature of zero divisors in Rx. Let me put some ink before, I think I am running out of it. So since we are given that this is a zero divisor, so by the definition of a zero divisor, there will be another polynomial gx which is non-zero, such that if you take the product of fx and gx, you will get zero, the zero polynomial. So we start the solution from that point. Since fx is a zero divisor, there exists some gx equal to say b naught plus b one x etc. bn x to the power n in Rx minus 0. That means g is not the zero polynomial. Such that fx gx is equal to 0. Now, since we want gx to be non-zero, that means at least one coefficient of gx should be non-zero, and without loss of generality, we can assume that coefficient to be bn. Because if something else is zero here, there is no need to write that. No, I mean, what I am trying to say here is that if bi is non-zero for some I less than n, but after i plus 1, i plus 2, etc., I plus n, for those suffixes, the corresponding b's are all 0. Then we would not write this much, this many terms. We would stop at bi x to the power I. So without loss of generality, we can assume bn to be non-zero. Now, if one carries out the actual multiplication of these two polynomials, say, let me write the polynomials. This is equal to 0. The highest term will be x to the power n plus m, and its coefficient will be bn am. That will also be 0 because the product is 0. After you perform the multiplication, all the coefficients will be 0. So let's write like this. Not only is bn am 0, but the other coefficients are also 0. From among them, we are going to choose the coefficients that we will need. But before that, let us say something about this also. You see, bn is non-zero. That means this polynomial g has non-zero coefficient. It is, the polynomial is non-zero, so coefficients must be non-zero, at least one of them. But this may not be the coefficient with the smallest suffix that is non-zero. You, in any case, if you start from bn and then look at bn minus 1, bn minus 2, you will get a smallest I such that bi is non-zero. Below I, if the suffix dips below I, then the corresponding b's are going to be 0. Let I be the smallest non-negative integer such that bi is not equal to 0. In brackets, we can write, note that I exists because bn is not equal to 0. Now, from fx gx equal to 0, we have these equations. A naught bi equal to 0, A naught bi plus 1 plus a1 bi is equal to 0, a0 bi plus 2 plus a1 bi plus 1 plus a2 bi is equal to 0. This is the coefficient of x to the power I in this product. This is the coefficient of x to the power I plus 1. And this one is the coefficient of x to the power I plus 2 in this product. All of them are going to be 0 because the right hand side is 0. If you continue like this, you will see that ultimately you get a term like this, a m minus k plus 1 b n minus n or sorry not n I okay let me just see what I have written is correct or not I plus k minus
yes
I plus k minus 1 plus a m minus k plus 2 b. So this I have raised this by 1, I have to subtract 1 from here, I plus k minus 2 etc. And a m minus 1 b I plus 1 plus a m b I equal to 0. This is the coefficient of x to the power I plus m, where we have to say what k is. K is the minimum of m plus 1 and n minus I plus 1. If all these things seem very complicated, you do one thing. You take actual polynomials in place of fx and gx, many examples. There you verify this, you will understand why it is like this. Note one thing. Because k is the minimum of m plus 1 and n minus I plus 1, k is less than or equal to both of these integers. That means k is less than or equal to m minus 1. This means m minus k, we have plus 1 here, no? If I take 1 on that side, then m minus k we are writing. No, that's not what I wanted to say. I wanted to say this. This implies k plus 1. Oh, k minus 1 is less than or equal to m. So this term m minus k plus 1 can also be written as m minus k minus 1. So we are subtracting k minus 1 from m. Doing so gives us a suffix that is a non-negative integer. So a of that makes sense. That sort of a is there in the polynomial fx as a coefficient. Similarly, k is also less than or equal to n minus I plus 1. So if we look at this, I plus k minus 1, I plus k minus 1 is less than or equal to n. So I plus k minus 1 is less than or equal to n means that sort of b is present here, because the suffix is less than or equal to n. I mean, we have all the b's. After bn also we have other b's, but they are all 0. In any way, this happens to lie in within this available b's. only. So that's what we are going to write here. Note that k minus 1 is less than or equal to m, and I plus k minus 1. Is less than or equal to n. It's pretty confusing for me, these things. I probably won't be able to produce this if I have to produce it here itself without looking at these things. It will take time, but I am very bad with this kind of calculations. So we have got this. Now using these things, we can conclude something very interesting. Note that a naught b I is equal to 0, or rather b I a naught is equal to 0. So we can write from these equations, or from the above equations, we get bi a naught is equal to 0, which is nothing but the first one, just written differently. Keeping in mind that since these a naught bi, these are ring elements and the ring is commutative, that's why we are able to write like this. Now, because bi a naught is 0, if you multiply the second equation by bi, in the first term bi a naught will appear, that will make the first term 0. In the second term bi square will appear. So that gives us bi square a1 is equal to 0. What happens to this? Here you multiply this equation by bi square, so that bi square a naught, bi a naught is there, so this becomes 0. Bi square a1 is 0, we have that now here, so this term also becomes 0, and we will be left with bi cube a2. Continuing like this, ultimately we will have bi to the power m a m minus 1 is equal to 0. Hence bi to the power, oh, there, I think there will be one more. Now for am also we have one equation. M plus 1 am is equal to 0. Hence bi to the power this aj is equal to 0 for all j lying between 0 and m. Note that bi to the power m plus 1 is not equal to 0 because bi is not equal to 0. Let us now see what we have got. We have proved that if we multiply all the coefficients of the polynomial f by this ring element bi to the power m plus 1, then we get zero, such products are zero. So in place of bi to the, I mean in place of b, that we were seeking a b, right, a non-zero b, if you multiply all the element, all the coefficients of the polynomial f by that b, we should get zero. Now this is one such b. Only thing is that it also has to be non-zero, and there that condition is used, that the ring has no non-zero nilpotent element. Since bi is non-zero, so no positive integral power can be equal to zero, because otherwise bi will be a non-zero nilpotent element, which is not allowed. So this completes the solution. But before we move on to the next exercise, let us try to interpret the result in this exercise that we have just now solved. What it says is this: if in Rx you have a zero divisor fx, then by the definition of a zero divisor, there will be a non-zero element gx here, such that fx gx is equal to zero. This exercise tells us that that non-zero element can also be chosen to be inside the ring itself, because you see, since all these products are zero, so this will also be zero. This will also be zero, but this is nothing but fx. So if you have a zero divisor in that type of polynomial ring, where the underlying ring has no non-zero nilpotent element, then the element by which you will multiply the given polynomial, that will make it zero, can be chosen from inside the ring itself. You need not choose a general polynomial. Okay, and this is a very strong result, because it makes life easy. A general polynomial is something very complicated. In its place, if you can choose a ring element, then see how easy the multiplication itself is. You just have to multiply all the terms by this, and that's all. Okay, then exercise 6. It's a starred exercise, that means its solution will be difficult. Exercise 6 asks us to show just this thing, but we have to drop the hypothesis that R has no non-zero nilpotent element. Without the hypothesis also it is true. Do exercise 5. By dropping the assumption that R has no non-zero nilpotent element. And the solution goes like this. Okay. Since again fx is a zero divisor, first of all, fx itself is non-zero. According to Hartstein, zero itself is not a zero divisor. Zero divisors are by definition non-zero elements. In other books, some authors allow zero to be zero divisor, so you have to be absolutely sure which convention is being followed. For Hartstein, zero is not a zero divisor. Now, because again, we are going to write that there is a polynomial gx which is non-zero, such that fx gx is zero, and that is coming from the fact that fx is a zero divisor. Now, such a polynomial exists which is non-zero, that means it has some degree. So, such a polynomial of minimum possible degree will also exist. So, let gx not equal to 0 be a polynomial in Rx of minimum degree such that fx gx equal to 0. In the previous solution, we did not use we did not choose gx to have the minimum possible degree. Here, however, we are choosing, and we can do so. Okay, now simply from this product, I haven't written any expression for gx. I should have written it here itself. V1x plus etc. Now, if one multiplies fx and gx, then the coefficient of x to the power, that is the highest term, will be anbm. Go to the expressions for the polynomials, carry out the multiplication. You will see that the last term is this. So that means this will be equal to 0 because the product is 0. This implies anbm is equal to 0. We want to claim that if we multiply this gx by an, this ring element, then that product also has to be 0. Suppose this is not equal to 0. Contrary to that claim, we are supposing that this is not equal to 0. Then degree of an gx is less than or equal to m minus 1, which is less than m, that is the degree of gx, and what are these things? The supposition is clear. We have supposed this thing and we are now expecting a contradiction. Why are we writing degree of this is less than or equal to m minus 1? You see, if you multiply, let me show that here. This is gx, right? B naught plus b1x plus b2x square, etc. to bm x to the power m. This is gx. Now, this polynomial a n gx is this . Now use the fact that a n b m is 0. B m minus 1 x to the power m minus 1. That is, we have written the previous term and this term becomes 0. And if we are supposing that this polynomial, which is a n g x, if this is non-zero, that means this polynomial is non-zero. So being non-zero, it will have some degree, and that degree, you can see, cannot be m, because the coefficient of x to the power m has become 0. It will be something that is less than or equal to m minus 1. Either it is m minus 1 when this is non-zero, or it is something smaller. So that's why this, and m minus 1 is less than m, which is the degree of gx. One more thing is that if we multiply fx by this polynomial using the fact that polynomial multiplication is associative and commutative, you can write like this and use this, you get 0. So what is it that we are getting now? We have obtained a polynomial a n g x in R x which has degree smaller than m, and yet if you take the product f x with that polynomial, you get 0, and this contradicts the minimality of m, because we chose g x to be a polynomial of minimum degree that if you multiply with f x gives you 0. So a polynomial of lower degree should not be able to do that same thing, and that is a contradiction. So this contradicts the minimality of m. Thus, our last supposition is wrong. That is, we must have a n g x equal to 0. Okay, so now a n g x is 0. We now show a j g x is also equal to 0 for all j lying between 0 and m. Have I messed up the suffixes? I mean, In the original polynomial fx, it ends with amx to the power n. Okay, and here we have bn of ambn. So that means this will be am. It's a small mistake, but nevertheless a mistake. Yeah, now it is making sense from 0 to n. Okay, fine. Note that f of x minus am x to the power m times gx is equal to fx gx minus am gx x to the power m. So both of these become 0, so this is equal to 0. Okay, so now we are considering a different product of this polynomial. We have subtracted am x to the power m from fx. That means this polynomial is just this. This one. We have subtracted the last term. We have removed the last term. And then we are considering the product of that with gx. That also turns out to be equal to 0. Just like the original fx and gx give us 0. If you remove the highest term from fx and then carry out the product, that also gives you 0. Okay, so now let I be the largest non-negative integer less than n. Less than m or less than, yes, less than m, such that ai is not equal to 0. Such that ai is not equal to 0. It may happen that there is no such I that is smaller than m and ai is not equal to 0, in which case the polynomial fx will look like this. If the suffix is smaller than m, I, then ai is equal to 0. Now note that we have already proved this thing. An here, you see, I had to write this again. I had to rectify this. Am. We already have proved the fact that amgx is equal to 0. Now, if the lower coefficients are all 0, then automatically this is true. I don't have anything else to prove. If you take j equal to m, then that case is here. If you take values of j smaller than m, then for those values aj itself is 0. So automatically the products will all be 0. So So that's why we write, if no such I exists, then we already have AJ GX equal to 0 for all J lying between 0 and M. So that means now we are looking at the case where there is at least one such I. Then zero is equal to fx minus am x to the power m gx is equal to a naught plus a1x etc plus ai x to the power I times gx. So here we are writing that this polynomial is equal to this, or I is the largest non-negative integer less than m for which ai is not equal to 0. If we go to higher values than I, then for those suffixes the corresponding ai's, I mean aj's, will be equal to 0. So that's why after ai we don't have any other non-zero term. So this polynomial becomes this times gx, and this is equal to 0. We have already seen it here. So we now are in this position, which implies just like there we here from this equation we concluded that the coefficient of the highest term is 0. Here also if you calculate the coefficient of the highest term, it will be ai b n. And you can carry out the same argument like this, starting from here, starting from this product being 0, just like from here you carried out this argument and you obtained this amgx is equal to 0. You start from this product being 0 and you can ultimately conclude this. Ai b n equal to 0. Now carrying out an argument AJ GX is equal to 0 for all J lying between I and N. You may ask what happened to the intermediate values of J. When J takes the value M, again I have written when j takes the value m, we have amgx equal to 0, that we have proved here. And then we are mentioning that carrying out a similar argument like above, we are getting aigx equal to 0. So when j is equal to I, we have this case. What about the values I plus 1, I plus 2, intermediate values? For those values, the ais themselves are, ages themselves are 0. So automatically the corresponding products will also be 0. And one can continue like this, proceeding like this. We eventually get aj gx equal to 0 for all j lying between 0 and m. Okay. Now, since all these products are 0, in particular, if you take the largest, the coefficient of the largest term, means term of highest possible degree in gx, which is because gx is this, no? This equations tell us that ajbn is equal to 0 for all such variations of j. And that's what we wanted to show. We just needed a b, so that if you multiply every coefficient of fx by that b, you get 0. The only other condition is that that b has to itself be non-zero. And bn is non-zero because that's how we chose g. Have we mentioned that bn is non-zero? Yeah, bn is non-zero, it's understood, because that is the highest coefficient of g. If it is 0, then you will choose a lower coefficient. There is no point in writing that in the expression for g. If we have not explicitly written in the beginning, when we consider gx for the first time, that bn is non-zero, you can just add that there. Note that bn is not equal to 0. So despite not having the hypothesis that the ring has no non-zero nilpotent element, the result is still true, although the proof is somewhat more complicated. And then another one. So this was this exercise and the previous one tell us something about zero divisors in Rx. Now we are going to look at units in Rx. If R is a commutative ring with unit element, and it is given that R is not equal to the zero ring. R having a unit element and R being not equal to the zero ring is equivalent to saying that the unit element in R is different from the zero element. Because you see, if R is the zero ring which has only one element, then this same element is also a unit element. By the definition of a unit element, it's an element one such that x1 must be equal to x for all x in the ring, x1 and 1x. Now, since the only element in this ring is 0 itself, so if you think of 0 as unit, let's just write that as 0u, then 0u, 0, 0u, 0u, 0 is equal to 0. So you can think of 0 in place of x. So this equation is satisfied. So in the zero ring, the zero element is the unit element. Conversely, if in any ring the zero element is equal to the unit element, then that ring has to be the zero ring. Why? Because you take any element x in R, if 1 is equal to 0, then x is equal to x1, but 1 is equal to 0, and by ring properties x0 is equal to 0, so x has to be equal to 0. That means if your ring is a non-zero ring and it has a unit element, then that unit element must be different from 0. Okay, so what does the exercise say? Prove that plus a n x to the power n in Rx has an inverse in Rx. That is a unit in Rx. Inverse means multiplicative inverse. If and only if. So it's a characterization of units in Rx. A naught is a unit in R and the other coefficients a1, a2, etc., an are nilpotent elements in R. So such a polynomial will be a unit in the polynomial ring if and only if the constant term is a unit in the underlying ring and the other coefficients are nilpotent elements in the underlying ring. Note that it's both ways. If that happens, then this is a unit, and if this is a unit, then all those conditions must be true. Before solving the exercise, prove a result that will be useful. Let X be a nilpotent element in R, and let N be the smallest positive integer such that x to the power n is equal to 0. In other words, n is the degree of nilpotency of x. Then if look at this, 1 plus x times 1 minus x plus x square minus x cube etc. n minus 1 x to the power n minus 1. You already know that this identity is true. Just like for real numbers it's true, it's in a commutative ring with unit element also it is true. Keep in mind that these are I probably should not have taken x, no, because we are using x here. Let me take something else. Let me take anything else we can take, say y. This is equal to 1 plus y to the power n. It's an identity from elementary algebra that continues to be true in a commutative ring with unit element. And the proof, you already know how the proof goes. You just multiply the terms out, then there are many cancellations. You are left with these two terms. And this is equal to 1. Note that in our ring R, we have obtained two elements, one is this and the other one is this. Their product gives us the multiplicative identity, the unit element. Now, before concluding that 1 plus y is a unit, we have to make sure that this thing is not equal to 0. Note that if we suppose then above equation implies on the left hand side we have 0, so it will be 0, on the right hand side we have 1. Which would in turn imply that the ring must be the zero ring. So it will contradict the hypothesis. So we must have not equal to 0. Now we can say that 1 plus y has a multiplicative inverse, and this is the inverse. Hence 1 plus y is a unit in R. We have thus proved that if y is a nilpotent element, then 1 plus y is a unit. In fact, a slightly more general result is true. In place of 1, you can take any unit. Let u belonging to R be any unit, since u inverse y is nilpotent, that is because u inverse y whole to the power n is equal to 0. U inverse y whole to the power n is u inverse to the power n times y to the power n, and that is true because we are in a commutative ring. In a general ring, you cannot write like that. AB whole to the power n is not necessarily equal to A to the power n times B to the power n. That is true only in a commutative ring. And we are in a commutative ring. So this is also a nilpotent element. So 1 plus u inverse y is a unit in R. Now if you multiply these two units, u and this, that is also a unit, because if you take the product of two elements, each one of which has a multiplicative inverse, then the product will also have a multiplicative inverse, because units in R form a group under multiplication. Thus u plus y, which is equal to u times 1 plus u inverse y, is a unit in R. We are going to use this fact that if we add a unit and a nilpotent element in the type of ring that we are considering, then that sum is again a unit. Now we solve the exercise. 1/2 of the exercise is quite straightforward now that we have this result. The other half will, that is also straightforward, but it needs a little bit more effort. First, assume A naught is a unit in R and A1, A2, A3, etc. up to AN, these are nilpotent elements in R. Then A naught is a unit in Rx. If it's a unit in R, then automatically it's a unit in Rx. And a1x, a2x square, anx to the power n, these are nilpotent elements in Rx. how are these nilpotent elements in Rx? See, because A1, for example, say A1 is nilpotent, so there will be a positive integer m, such that A1 to the power m is equal to 0. Now you look at this A1x. What will happen if we take the mth power of this? Because we are in a commutative ring, just like the original ring, the polynomial ring is also commutative. This is equal to, so you can see that you get the zero element. So just like that, all these monomials are individually nilpotent. Now we apply this result repeatedly. Because a naught is unit in Rx and a1x is nilpotent, so a naught plus a1x will be a unit in Rx. Now that is a unit in Rx, and a2x square is nilpotent, so this again will be a unit in Rx. Like this, if you continue, you ultimately get the fact that this is a unit in Rx. In other words, our polynomial is a unit in Rx. Now, applying the result of the previous paragraph, repeatedly, we get that a naught plus a1 x etc plus a n x to the power n is a unit in Rx. Now we will prove the converse, but before that I need ink. Conversely, let, oh, we did not give any name to this. Okay, let's just call it fx. In the previous part, we did not name the polynomial. Being a unit means what? There will exist a polynomial gx such that if you take the product fx gx, you will get 1. Then this is equal to 0. Oh, sorry, 1. Now we will equate the coefficients. The constant term of the left hand side will be equal to 1, all the other terms will be equal to 0. So we get these things. This implies a naught b naught is equal to 1 and summation ai bj, where I plus j is equal to k, is equal to 0 for all. What are the values of k that we need? We are considering the values of k from n to n plus m, say. For other values of k also, it is true, except for that 0. But we don't, we are not going to need those things. We need only this part of the equations, of the list of equations. Since R is a non-zero ring, and hence 1 is not equal to 0. Is R non-zero a part of this? Yes, okay. Since R is non-zero and hence 1 is not equal to 0, we must have B naught not equal to 0 from here. So A naught B naught equal to 1 implies A naught is a unit in R. So that we have proved. A naught must be a unit in R. Now what happens when k is equal to n plus m? In that case, in this sum, there is only one term, that is a n b m. The coefficients of the highest terms in f and g respectively. A n b m is equal to 0. Then the next one will be a n minus 1 b m plus a n b m minus 1. That is the coefficient of x to the power n plus m minus 1. That is the next lower value of k. And from that equation we will get something. From a n minus 1 b m plus a n b m minus 1 equal to 0, we get, since a n b m is equal to 0, if we multiply on both sides by a n, we will get a n square b m minus 1 is equal to 0, because the first term after multiplying by a n becomes 0 due to this equation, and the second term becomes this, that is equal to 0. Now if we keep going like this, proceeding like this, we get a n to the power r plus 1 b m minus r is equal to 0 for all r lying between 0 and m. You can do the calculation for 2 or 3 more steps and verify this. The pattern is clear here. If you have 1 here, you have 1 more, 2. If you have 2 here, you will have 3 here. That you can see from the next calculation, where you will consider this equation, a n minus 2 b m plus a n minus 1 b m plus 1 plus a n b n minus 2 n minus 1 n m m plus 1. Wait, what? I am confusing myself. N minus 2 and m, so together they give us n plus m minus 2. Minus 1 minus 2, this is equal to 0. In this equation, if you multiply both sides by a n square, then this will become 0 because of this, this will become 0 because of this, and this one will give you a n cube b m minus 2 equal to 0. In general, you will get this. Thus, a n to the power m plus 1 b m minus r is equal to 0 for all r varying from 0 to m. This is something we have got ultimately. This implies a n to the power m plus 1 is this times 1, and that is equal to f x g x, because originally f x g x was equal to 1, and from there itself we are getting all these calculations. So this is equal to f x g x, and so we can multiply these things with gx. So let's write accordingly, gx fx. Now if we multiply the coefficients of gx by this, we will get what? A n to the power m plus 1 b naught plus a n to the power m plus 1 b 1 x, like this. B m x to the power m. Let me verify what we have written is correct or not. The fact that this is 0 is coming from these equations. If r is 0, then I get bm. So that means this product is 0. If r is 1, I get bm minus 1. So the previous one will be 0. Like that, all the way up to the case r equal to m. When we put r equal to m, we get b naught. So this will be 0. So yes, this product is equal to 0. Hence, so a positive integer m plus 1 has been found such that this power is equal to 0. So what does this tell you? It tells us that An is a nilpotent element in R. This implies minus an x to the power n is a nilpotent element in Rx. We have already seen once why that is so. You take the m plus 1th power of this element in Rx, you get 0. So, by the result of the previous exercise, fx minus an x to the power n that is equal to x to the power n minus 1 is a unit, because you see now we are in Rx and fx is given to be a unit and this is a nilpotent element, so their sum will be a unit. That's what we proved in the first paragraph. This is a unit in Rx. We now have a polynomial with one term less than fx. That is also a unit in Rx. So whatever we have done here can also be done with this polynomial in place of fx. Doing so, we will get the fact that an minus 1 is also nilpotent, just like here we proved that an is nilpotent. Then from that you can conclude that minus an minus 1 x to the power n minus 1 is nilpotent in Rx. Add that with this polynomial, you get another polynomial of one term less than this one, that is also a unit, and you continue this procedure, you will get the fact that an minus 2, an minus 1, all the way up to a1, these are all nilpotent elements. So we can write like this. So repeating the whole procedure, with the unit in Rx, we can similarly conclude that a minus 1 is nilpotent in R, and continuing like this, we get that A1, A2, these are all nilpotent in A1. in R. So a converse part has also been proved. So that's it for this video. In the next video, we will try to solve the other 8 problems that we have in this set of exercises. After this, there are also the supplementary exercises that also we will see. So with this, I sign off. This is me, Lucifer, from a mathematical room. Have a nice night.